بسم الله والحمد لله نبدأ. The talk will try to raise one issue, that sustainability cannot be achieved within capitalism or socialism. Of course, some might refuse the concept that only Islam can do that. Now it is my duty to try to prove that. The purpose of this presentation is to bring your attention to two books. I spent my life working on them. The last one is Qas al-Haq, and the first one is Crisis in the Built Environment. And Crisis of the Built in the Built Environment is basically my doctoral thesis. Now, both available in the net, and you can download them and see them. The difference between both of them, the book of Qas al-Haq, which means scissoring rights, is the emphasis on the economy and decision making process on environmental level and on political level. The book of Crisis in the Built Environment is basically urbanism. So the two books try to complete each other. Now it would be impossible for me to explain the content of the two books. That's why I'll just give you a hint of what is the book is about. This is the cover of the second edition of The Crisis in the Built Environment. That will be available soon, inshallah, in maybe 6-7 weeks. It will be available in the market. And it can be downloaded, of course. Now, in the Western culture, they have this debate that organized societies, ordered societies, cannot be achieved without sort of government. This thing comes always, admit, it closes, it comes back again, disturbing. Anyhow, so if there is no government, the society will be chaotic. So either, whether it is democratic or dictatorship or whatever, government in control of the society or anarchy. That's why the concepts of those people who are trying to create self-managed societies mostly defeated within the Western concept. In the theoretical level, it exists. However, in the practical level, you rarely see it. Societies are dominated by governments. So, either a society with hierarchy and bureaucracy, or a vacuum that would lead to chaos. Either, again, this is important, either a society characterized by a government that controls almost everything, to some degree differs from one society to another, or chaos. Now in Islam it's different. It's minimal size state. However, this vacuum is filled with the Islamic legal system, which is hukuk. I see many people are coming. Maybe there is 10 more people that came late. Let me summarize quickly what I said. Within the Western mentality, societies should be run by the state or it is chaotic. Now, within the Islamic culture, as Islam came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is the hukuk, sharia. Sharia is basically, among other things, is hukuk. Hukuk is rights, individual rights, property rights. Now, if those rights were activated, the size of the state will be very minimal. So it is not either, as the Westerners in their philosophy argue, state or vacuum and chaos. No, there is hukuk that will fulfill this vacuum. Now in the Western culture, they produce theories and then they discover later that it is not true. And those theories affect the fields of economy, the field of political science, and so on. For example, Malthusian theory that says the resources of the earth one day will vanish. Now they found out that is not true. For example, the idea of the tragedy of the commons. And this is very well known, that if there is a pasture land, and if everybody raises cattle there, this pasture land, if everybody takes whatever he can, one day will die. Now, Elinor Ostrom came and she got the Nobel Prize to solve this problem by saying, well, there is in the traditional cultures, like the one in Switzerland, like the one in Indonesia, the people don't fight over grazing lands or over the commons. They develop agreements, they develop rules, and so on. So it is not as everybody is saying before Elinor Ostrom that to save those commons, those properties has to be controlled by the state or has to be privatized. So it doesn't have controlled or private. It could be controlled by the people living in the site. So from these examples, Malthusian's theory and the tragedy of the common, you can see that the philosophy of economy is fluctuating over time. And through their concept of rights of precedence that the law develops, gradually they develop rules and regulations like planning theory, property rights, taxation, and so on, all leading to a bureaucratic society. Now I will raise three issues and another three issues. The three issues that I will raise, that I'll try to connect, monopoly, injustice, that leads to unsustainability and pollutions, climate change, etc. Monopoly, injustice, that leads to unsustainability and pollutions. And human destiny cannot run away with this Western mentality of controlling the society because they don't think of hukuk. They develop their own rights. Those developed rights leads to injustice, and that's what I'll try to explain. And this strategy of monopoly, injustice, leads to unsustainability. The other three issues that I want to bring your attention to is consumption, production, comfort, happiness, etc. Now, as you know, as you will all know, that if we continue, now bear in mind that there is two things, the theoretical arguments between academics and the real life. In reality, no matter what we do, we are increasing pollution, climate change, and so on. So if the people live as the Australians do, we need 5.4 Earth to have a sustainable Earth. If we live like the United States individuals do, we need 4.8 size of the current Earth so the Earth can clean itself. Regarding countries, the South Koreans need 8.4 the size of their country to have an environment that will not pollute. These are very well-known figures, and I think from 2016. Now, those problems that you all know about unsustainability led to a puzzling question. What do we do? When you look at the videos that what they are trying to do, you will see that they are thinking within capitalism. So humanity is searching for a system that is fair, open, and transparent, a system that is based on meritocracy. Yet, as they say, some of them, Fukuyama, history has ended, and now liberal democracy, in reality, free market, is winning. And some argue that capitalism has the capacity to adjust itself to even deal with this coming pollution, inevitably. So many philosophers, many researchers trying to deal with the problem appeared, like David Harvey, Richard DeWolf, for example, Jeremy Rifkin, who are thinking of the future, the history of the future. Just look at these names and go to the internet and see what they are doing. Paul Mason, Christian Felber, Richard Florida. These guys are trying to solve sustainability within the capitalist system. And that's why I argue that we can never come out of this impasse. So this is what I'm trying to achieve. Now we will start. Let me summarize, because some people came late, that with the Western concept of paradigms of living, we are heading for pollution. That's our destiny. No matter what we do, we can never come out of the disaster that's coming. Why? Because they thought, they're still thinking, that state, if there is no state, there is vacuum, then there is chaos. While we in the Islamic built environment, we have another proposal, which is there is hukuk, or rights. Those property rights and individual rights will fill this vacuum. Now, in the Muslim world, there is three types of relationships. The relationship of individual with God, how to pray, how to fast, and so on. Relationship between, in terms of rights among individuals, and relationship between individuals and the state. Unfortunately, the emphasis from most ulama, most religious elites, and so on, emphasize the relationship between the person and the God, and sometimes between people, but not between the individuals and the state. That's left for some scholars who, through Maqasid, through, they enlarge the size of the area for the state to have more control. So the size of, or the body of responsibilities of the state was enlarged on the expense of the responsibilities of individual. So as time goes by in the Muslim world, the state becomes more and more powerful. And that's why the Western culture now cannot see what could happen in the Muslim world if the Muslim world ruled by Islam. That's my argument. That we are Muslims, we pray, we fast, everything. But when it comes to relationship between the state and individuals, it is left for some who, through ijtihad, gave the state more authority. So the argument is, regardless of people, culture, or religion, they don't have to be Muslim. We might save human civilizations by learning from traditional environments, especially from individuals and properties rights, which give end users maximum control with no damage to others and the environment through hukuk. Hukuk, for those who don't know Arabic, is rights, human rights, property rights. Current economic and political structures will not lead us to sustainable environment because our current regulative system is brought from the West. Now, let me put forward this argument. To use the Islamic hukuk, people doesn't have to be Muslims. Anybody can use, any society can use Islamic hukuk. Let me give one example. The example of the dead end street. Now, in the Islamic legal system, the dead end street legally is owned by the people living around it. Now, those people, when living around it, when they own it, they may build a gate for it. They may use it the way they like. So if they were Muslims, and very good Muslims maybe, Maybe they will put dim lights and they pray after breakfast in Ramadan and they worship God. If they were non-Muslims, or let's say young guys who want to enjoy life, they may have colorful lights and they may dance in it the whole night with music. Now, because the people in the two dead end streets, on the street, in one of them they're praying, in the other they're dancing, the consequences environmentally always the same in the two streets. Because the street will collect them together and it will create social bonds between them. Taking care of what's in the street in terms of electricity, for example, lighting the street, is the people's responsibility. So the people has to get together to pay for it, whether Muslims or not. Taking care of sewage, cleaning the street, all these aspects are the responsibility of the people of the street who own it. So if we think like this, we can reduce the percentage of public spaces in the city. It doesn't have to be a dead-end street. It could be open street, however, controlled by gates from both sides, or controlled by cameras from both sides. It doesn't have to be physically dead-end. So when we throw responsibility on the people, the cost of maintaining the city will be reduced. Then we have surplus that we can spend financially on education, on health, on whatever. This is in Tunis, and this is another example that a dead-end street was used as parking space. So the people has the right to control it. This is from Izmir. When the people lost control of the dead-end street, what happens? Some people may act against the wish of those living in the dead-end street. Now here, this is a cafe that took part of the dead-end street because he got permission from the municipality. I asked the guy, why do you do this? He said, I got permission from the municipality. The people living on the site cannot stop him. They lost control. In the traditional environment, whether the people were Muslim or no, because they have control, they can stop such actions. Even there is a toilet at the end of the street. You see the mouse, right? Now this is in, I think, Tunis or Morocco, I forgot. Because the people lost control, this guy managed to take part of the street and make the street narrower. So the point I'm trying to make from this slide is the following. Right, regardless of the people culture, Muslims or non-Muslims, the concept that the dead end street is owned by the people around it will create certain circumstances, economic, political, in the society. Here in Asila in Morocco, I was passing and I saw this garbage here. So curiously, I went inside to see a living space that owned by the people around it. And this space became like a living room, although it is a square or a small dead end street. So the people may, in such situation, rather than having electric poles in the street, they might light their streets like this. And then we will have, because each street has its own unique flavor, unique people, we'll have diversities of lighting the streets. And those diversities will compete among each other, and gradually the best solution will be repeated again and again, and it becomes a convention. That's why we see the Muslim cities have certain conventions repeated again and again. Now somebody, I'll spare this question, somebody may ask me later, how does it differ from the Italian cities or Greek cities, for example? There are similarities between buildings. I'll answer that later. It's not time for that. So just making them who live around the dead-end street the owners of the dead-end space, and regardless of their religion or culture, led to certain consequences. Now, this is the argument I'm trying to make in this slide. This is the most important slide. You remember in the beginning, for those who came late, I said, with the Western philosophy, if there is no state, mostly there is chaos. And there are some people trying to overcome that with some ideas. Like this lady who won the Nobel Prize, Elinor Ostrom, she defeated this concept of the tragedy of the common by saying, no, there is possibility that the people can organize themselves. But the generality is that societies should be governed. Otherwise, it's chaos. Governance leads to rules and regulations. You cannot govern society without rules and regulations. This is impossible. Now, rules and regulations will create two things, monopoly and bureaucrats. In best cases like the North, like the Scandinavian countries, if things were very transparent and they were very honest and so on, you may not have monopoly, but there still you have bureaucrats. You have a class of people who are doing paperwork and not producing real goods like shirts, glasses, cameras, engines, cars. They are producing bureaucracy. Now, you may argue that we cannot live without bureaucracy. And that's what I'll try to prove. Maybe it's difficult in this session, but it is in the book. I tried. That we can, with hukuk, I should say hukuk, we can create societies without bureaucracy, yet it functions well. In worst cases, like it's happening in third world countries, there is monopoly. Even in some Western countries, there is monopoly. Why? Rules and regulations always can be manipulated. And there is so much writings in the Western culture that proves that there is corruption. Rules and regulations can always be bypassed, can be given to the right of fishing in this in certain area can be given to this and not that. The right of privatizing the railway, for example, can be given to this and not that. All decisions by the government can go east or west. And that leads to monopoly. So monopoly and bureaucracy will lead to stratification in the society. This is well known. This is all well known. I know all you know this. But bringing those ideas together will make the difference. And this is what is important. Stratification leads to poor people seeking job. No matter what. Always, if you look at the economy, there is always percentage of the people who are not employed. Stratification leads to poor people seeking job. Now, those poor people seeking job will be hit hard because they need money. They work hard to make a living. So flogging the needy for more work. And you see them in the mines. They don't own the mines. They work very hard. The majority of the people in our societies, they don't own what they work in. We are all employed. We take salary at the end of the month. We work for others. Stratification leads to poor seeking jobs, leads to flogging the needy for more work. And this leads to maximizing the profit. Why? Because there is investors who can flog those poor to work harder, and then profit is maximized, which means more production, more pollution. And with more stratification, more poverty. But you might argue now and say, well, this is normal. What is the new about it? What's new about it, that in the Islamic legal system, this stratification will not appear, and those people seeking job, they will not exist. And that's what I'll show now. And because those poor people who are seeking job will not exist, factories cannot work 24 hours because factories will be operated by the people working in them who owns them. And because they have limited capabilities, they will work less. They cannot work more than 8 hours. And if they want to hire other people, they have to pay very high wages. Why? I'll explain now. So hukuk in Islam leads, that's what I'm arguing, to no bureaucracy. Let me take one example now, then I'll come back to the subject. I'll take urban example, then I'll come back to the subject. Let me take the discharging rainwater as an example. There is a spine, I'm going through a spinal argument. I'll go out, come in, go out, come in. This is in the southern part of Morocco called Wadi Daraa. And they have very fascinating architecture there, built with mud. What's interesting about this, what interested me, is that how they manage to discharge rainwater. And this is not only in Daraa, it's in all the Muslim world. Why? Because it relates to hukuk, relates to rights. Here you can see the mud houses with rain will dissolve easily. How they manage to deal with rain. Look at this. There is rights that when you revive a land, I'll come to that later, those who know some about Islamic architecture, there is something called mawat, dead land. People can revive dead lands. When they revive dead lands, there is certain rights they should follow. They cannot revive a land in the middle of the valley. Now, there was a housing project in Jeddah, hundreds of houses, was built in the valley and closed the pathway of rainwater. Now this will happen. Where does the water go? This one will happen. To solve that problem, they have to make all kinds of huge pipes to suck the water and throw it to the sea or the valleys. Imagine the cost that was created by stopping rights and depending on rules and regulations that led to this cost. Now, all over the world, as you know, rainwater is thrown from the roofs to the street, collected to smaller streets, to larger streets. This is, for example, Tehran. All cities like that in the world, modern cities. However, in the traditional built environment, like the city in North Africa, and this is Tunis and Tangiers, you can see, although the buildings are compact, which makes it difficult to get rid of rainwater, what do they do? That the guy who revived his property first, he has the right to discharge, hukuk, he has the right to discharge his rainwater to the outside. Now, the guys who builds next to him has to deal with that rainwater as constraint. When he revived, the second reviver, when he revived his property, he has to deal with the water of the first reviver. So the water, as you can see here, throwing from one roof to another roof, to a third roof, to a fourth roof, and they go from one building to one building, to another, to another, to another. This is from Tunis, even in the market. Even I saw some buildings here in Turkey, in Bursa. It doesn't have to be compact buildings in Safranbolu. It doesn't have to be compact buildings, even if they are freestanding. If somebody asks, I'll answer that. So if we look at the traditional environment, this is Jazair, water goes from one roof to another, and gradually, maybe to the street or to the outside. Here, for example, it goes to the street in Esrir, in a village in northern Morocco. Here it goes inside a house, because this guy revived after that guy, and that there is hukuk, there is rights. The right of this house is to discharge rainwater in this house. So, now, cleaning the rainwater channels becomes very easy to the society, and it costs nothing. Now, somebody might say, oh, no, this is terrible. I cannot live in a society like this. Why? Because I don't want to clean the rainwater. I want the city to do that. I want the government to do that. I'll say, okay, you have to pay tax. And when tax is collected to cover these expenses, it may not be used efficiently. But within the Islamic legal system, companies may appear to resolve these problems. I'll explain that, inshallah. Here you can see one of the cases that really brought my attention in the 1980s. I read a case in one of the jurisprudence books that there is a gully of water over a staircase. And this house owner is complaining about the gully of water. It has to be removed. The judge said, no, it cannot be removed because this guy came later. This guy came later, which means there is accretions of decisions. This guy should deal with this water spout and take care of the water of his neighbor. Why? Because we want a society with land value almost zero. So who comes first is served first, within a limit, of course. And he gains rights. The other comers who come later has to respect these rights. Here is another water channel inside a reception room. This guy has to clean this every while and then. Then it goes to the street. So this problem of rainwater, which is all khair, good, was treated in our society as a problem, and they didn't know how to deal with it, except with huge pipes. In the traditional environment, it goes from one roof to another roof gradually to the valleys. And those valleys are well respected and considered rights for the people living around it. Nobody can build on it. But now, it was given as an allotment or for a project, it was built on. Then cities will sink with water. Then it goes here, goes to the sea. Through channels, it goes to the sea or to the valleys. So gravity is utilized to deal with problem rainwater with no cost. The same goes for developing, let's say, digesters to deal with the sewage water. So dealing with environmental problems will be localized. When they are localized, they will develop gradually with new inventions. Unfortunately, this line of thinking is not that well spread. What's spread is the solutions that comes from the state, which is mostly central. Now, this whole idea of centralization, decentralization, I hope someone will raise it at the end. I don't like the term centralization, decentralization, because decentralization means that the government willingly gave the people some rights. However, with hukuk, it is given because it is given from God and the Prophet. It cannot be changed. So it cannot be manipulated. It is fixed all over the regions, all over the times. The same goes for digesters. How are we doing with time? Oh, I have so much to go. Now,
I think we have 5 minutes left.
Well, I didn't finish. I have so much. Give me 15 more minutes, okay? So these traditional solutions, I insist. Okay, I insist. I need 15 more minutes. These traditional wisdoms did not have the chance to operate these days. That's why we don't see these solutions. What do we see? We see when the people get power, we see sites like these where people are poor and they will, because they are poor, they will create poor environment. Why they are poor? Because there is injustice. Now look at this guy. Now these days we all dislike this situation, okay, because it's very clear, okay? But it was there in the built environment. This is wrong, for example. How much does it cost to make one column? How much does it cost? Compare this to the other localities at that time where the people were poor. So there is injustice. The same now, you see it these days in these classic modern buildings. Sometimes you see it very clearly, like the pyramids. This is injustice. Sometimes it's hidden. This is in Stockholm. A seat that is cantilevered. The taxpayers, if they know that their money, some of them they don't understand, went under the ground for a basement support to carry this cantilever, they may not like it. We pass this. Now, remember I said in the beginning that people are flogged to work because they are unemployed, they have to work harder. Within our, if we implemented Islam, Islam has three essences, which is resources, permissions, and knowledge. These three essences, you can read them if you like, are always within those who manage to get them. Resources like lands, like minerals, like are owned by those who possess them. And that's in the Qasr al-Haq in the videos of Khairat. Okay, resources. Permission also, people can have their own factories, build their own farms, or whatsoever, without permission from the state, without permission, on the condition that they will not damage others and the locality. Now, what happens is that if the people are free to act without permission, and they have the resources, knowledge is debatable, you can leave that to the end. Why do I work for you? I work next to you. Gradually, the society will be composed of individuals that they are very close in to each other in their income. They're very close, not stratification, rich and poor. When they are very close to their income, because they can revive lands, because they can revive here a modern way of reviving lands. I have to go fast. What happens? The society will be composed in its production because most people can have access to resources, knowledge, and permission. These circles are individuals who own money. These circles are individuals who don't own money. So the production system in our days is that a rich man, investor, a millionaire, will hire others to work for him. And there is unemployed. A company can be composed of those rich men to have Toyota car, for example, or Honda, or Lockheed. While the production system, in that, if we implemented Islamic hukuk, because empowerment is open for the people, is people working together as partners. Look at this car. Now, this car is made by several companies. However, those companies, when they cooperate, the people working in these companies, they don't own the company. They are employees. With opening doors in these three essentials, what happens? That the people working in those companies are the owners of those companies. And there is most likely a situation, you know about the production, that they will cooperate with each other, will be more inventive, and so on. Gradually, the quality of the products will go higher. Why? Now I come to another concept, which is, if you look at the market these days, you will find the products in the market are three types. Necessities, like bread, house, jacket. Needed, milk, pen, refrigerator. Complementary, necktie, whatever. The mobile, for example, because in the beginning it was complementary, then it became needed, now it's necessity. All objects go through these stages. Now, the percentage of objects in the market, let's say 40% necessities, 30% needed, and so on, reflects the health of the society. Because when the people are close in their income, most objects will travel fast from being complementary to necessities, and those necessities will fill the market. Now, I will leave these slides. I read it fast. It's no time to explain it. Here you see a situation, this diagram. Can you see the mouse? There is dotted line, which means that there is no borders. This is if we implement Islamic hukuk. This is if we implemented the current system of bureaucracy, where there is borders between regions and countries. Here there is no borders. Here the people own their business, their own properties. The percentage of owners are very high. Here one person maybe owns so much and other people own nothing. So these two diagrams will have, let me read fast. If we implemented Islamic hukuk, because the people are not flogged to work in factories, they will think twice before they buy things. So the market will respond by manufacturing much necessary and needed products. No lavish yachts or fancy chandeliers. Competition is very high among the millions of producers of high quality needed objects with endless varieties. Little or no advertisement. Profit depends on merits. Here in the current situation, lavish products such as jewelry, watches are available on the market, while many are missing necessities. Competition is high among corporations, monopolizing commodities, spending much on advertisement, etc. The quality of some items are very high but not affordable by the masses. Profit depends much on convincing customers of the importance of the products. Here, if we implement Islamic hukuk, what happens? Limits of manufacturers depends on their ability to cooperate with others as partners. They can only produce the largest possible objects with their real capabilities. Thus, car, for example, will be produced by several groups of partners. Every manufacturer owner is participating in improving the quality of the product. Conventions are very important in the production of the process. If we implement the contemporary legal systems, limits of cooperation could be as high as their cunnings. They can always find methods to legalize their faults. Manufacturers are raising quality but hiding secrets. Improvement is within the company. No conventions, but patent products. Little space for free trade between free producers, but rather orders and supply.